Okay, so thanks everyone for coming, and thank you to the organizers of HCM for organizing this very wonderful conference. What I have to say today really comes out of this new book that Asha talked about. And in this book, very briefly, I make three arguments that are sort of encased in one another. So the most general argument is what I call my materiality of nations argument. That is to say that I argue that contrary to a lot of not only neoliberal theory but a lot of Marxist theory, which takes a more or less purely economic conception of capitalism, that states have always been centrally involved in capitalism, not just in founding capitalisms but also in regularly managing them. And this is in a large part because capitalism needs management. Capitalism has inherent crisis tendency, another aspect of it, which is very frequently forgotten in Marxist discourse of our time. And as a consequence, states have to remain involved. And then states' involvement in managing capitalisms then requires them to manage the domestic economy as well as manage the particular states' interactions internationally. So that's what I call the materiality of nations argument. And this international engagement, by the way, I should also add that I conceive of broadly in terms of uneven and combined development. Here also my interpretation is considerably different from the one that has become standard in recent times, because in addition to emphasizing the unevenness of capitalist development, I also emphasize combined development. Combined development, however, has been a notion that has, in our time at least, been largely confined to the idea of the development of socialism in backward nations. And I argue and I show that Trotsky, for example, in that classical first chapter of the history of the Russian Revolution, takes combined development to mean also capitalist combined development. And I argue also, I show that you cannot understand the history of capitalism and its spread around the world without this very, very important notion, including the idea of capitalist combined development. And so also I coined this term, and I don't go too much into it, but I coined this term geopolitical economy. And in fact, when I finally ended up coining it, I was even more astonished, not just astonished that I thought of this term, but more astonished that nobody else had. And I think this also demonstrates certain conceptions that are very deeply rooted in our today's Marxism, which we need to engage with and throughout what does not work. And in line with Marx, whose quote I have from the very, very last pages of the Grundrisse on caring, Marx, in line with what Marx says here, I think of geopolitical economy as the relations of producing nations. So unlike what most Marxists do, which is think about the world economy with concepts such as globalization, they even argue, for example, that Marx was the old theorist of globalization. Contrary to these tendencies, I argue that the world economy is indeed cut up into state, that is to say various national economies, and that the international relations, in order to understand them, contrary to these Marxists, you have to understand national economies, and contrary to the normal scholars of international relations, you have to understand the economic relations between producing nations. So that's the first argument. The second argument, very briefly going on from that, is that contrary to ideas about US hegemony and hegemony stability theories generally, the hegemony, so to speak, or the dominance, the world dominance of the UK economy was as inevitable as it was unrepeatable. The important consequence of this is that while the United States attempted to emulate, and by the way, this attempt at emulation was a very conscious thing, I also showed this, on the part of US elites, policymakers, and so on, so they attempted to emulate UK dominance, but they had to do it in very changed circumstances. In these changed circumstances, former colonialism, such as the UK enjoyed, was no longer possible. As a consequence, the US had to settle for making the dollar the world's money, in some sort of emulation of the pound sterling's rule over the world economy between 1987-1914 and whatever that way. And secondly, by making New York the world's financial center, much as London had been. and to some extent, of course, today continues to be in a formation that I call, the way I like to put it, is the London plays Robin to New York's Batman. So that's been the best for the last little while. So anyway, that's the second argument, that the US made a series of attempts to be hegemonic, all of which failed, despite the fact that this was already hegemony light compared to what the US had done, UK had done before. The third argument is very simply that discourses like globalization and empire, as well as hegemony stability theory, emerged, they emanated from the top levels of US policy making circles, and that these were ideologies of US attempts to keep the dollar as the world's money rather than actual social scientific theories about what went on out there. And indeed, it is a mark of how gullible the mainstream of international political economy has been towards discourses, how credulous they have been towards discourses emanating from US policymaking circles, that these were even taken to be social scientific theories. So that's the background. What I'm going to do now is I'm going to, in making these three arguments, I actually also ended up making a particular argument about how to understand financialization in relation to the dollar's world role. And this is what this is the aspect I'm now developing in the present paper. So I'm going to read most of it. Hopefully I will stay within my allotted time, but please warn me if I don't. Since the collapse of Lehman Brothers in September 2008, considerable attention has focused on the fortunes of the US dollar. Every uptick in its fortunes is hailed as proof of the dollar's continuing role as the world's currency. However, predictions of the end of that role and calls for replacing it or supplementing it and debates about the future of the international monetary system are also heard from influential quarters, including the governor of the People's Bank of China, the IMF, Britain's leading international relations think tank, Chatham House, and the United Nations. However, though the dollar's impressive rally in the closing months of 2008 ended, the dollar's fortunes since then have been mixed. Increases in US debts and deficits, successive rounds of quantitative easing, the continuing failure of US recovery and continuing high growth in the emerging economies, particularly China, have tended to drive the dollar down. On the other hand, crisis in the Eurozone in particular, now joined by a massive program of quantitative easing in Japan, have tended to shore it up. For at least one major scholar, Barry Eichengreen, the dollar's world role has been, quote, reinforced, unquote, by the crisis. And he cites a number of things, how much the dollar is still used in international transactions, how much, what a great proportion, 60% constitutes of foreign government's foreign currency reserves, etc., etc. He reads off a few statistics. Whereas previously he had seen the dollar as giving way to a multi-reserve currency future in which the euro and the Chinese yuan and possibly even other emerging economy currencies could play a role, that future, at least for the moment, has been postponed. This is a comment by Eichengreen made just last fall. Is this future really postponed? For how long? In this paper, I argue that an important problem with recent discussions of the dollar, including Eichengreen's, is that it continues to be conducted within the outdated frameworks which assume that the dollar's international role was never unproblematic, or that it assumes that it was unproblematic, whether under Bretton Woods or, as some term, the international monetary regime since 1971, Bretton Woods II. Such views were underpinned, of course, by theories of US hegemony. And in geopolitical economy, I also show very clearly that these ideas emerged, as I say, from very, very top-ranking policymaking circles. And what's more, they emerged in tandem with the increasing difficulties that the dollar was already having. Then it was the gold-backed dollar in performing its assigned world role. By contrast, an examination of the fundamental problems of the dollar's world role and US hegemony in my recent book focuses our attention on a key nexus, that between the dollar's world role and its need for liquidity, financialization, and financial crises. Here in this paper, I elaborate on it. The argument is that ever since the dollar's gold ring was broken in 1971, and by the way, the role was not unproblematic even before then, I'm just dividing the two sets of problems. So ever since that link was broken, the continuation of the dollar's world role has relied on a series of dollar-denominated financializations. they were necessary to give the dollar the liquidity it needed as an international reserve currency. Official and private holders rely on being able to acquire and dispose of them easily without loss of value. By using the term financialization in the plural, and by the way, financialization, as most people know, or at least most of you probably know, is that increases in proportion of monetary as opposed to productive transactions. So anyway, by using this term in the plural, I'm indicating the unique character of each successive episode. In pointing to the dollar-denominated character, I am pointing out that financializations were the systematic requirement of a national currency playing an international role in the historical circumstances of the 20th and 21st centuries. All of these clauses are quite important, as you'll see. There are several critical implications of this analysis. First, international financial reform aimed at promoting financial stability cannot avoid international monetary reform to displace the dollar from its international role. Secondly, any reform will have to take place, will have to take seriously the contradiction of national currencies playing international roles. This is particularly relevant because one widely considered scenario, probably the most likely one if there is no internationally coordinated effort to do something else, the scenario replacing the dollar involves multiple reserve currencies. Will they not merely replicate the problems that the dollar has on a smaller scale? Finally, this approach establishes, contrary to some, that the dollar's future will be determined by factors beyond the control of U.S. policymakers. One of my points is that U.S. policymakers can no longer control the fate of the dollar, although it does not mean they are not trying, they are definitely trying. In what follows, I first show that the dollar's fortunes have indeed trended downwards in the current crisis, appearances to the contrary. I then show that this downward slide is simply the continuation of a secular decline going back to the closing of the gold window, a decline spectacularly interrupted twice, but never reversed. Finally, I put this decline in a broader context of an understanding of the aims and methods of US attempts at hegemony throughout the 20th century, attempts which have all failed and can, in the wake of recent crises, no longer be made. So this is the first part now, the crisis and the dollar. So in figure one, the trade-weighted dollar index September 2008 onwards, we can see from it that the dollar's initial rally was followed by two long declines and two upticks. The last uptick is still ongoing. So far, the upticks have failed to take the dollar back to the peak it had reached in late 2008. And the ongoing rise of the dollar is less steep than the earlier one. Let us now put this some interpretative flesh on these lines. The dollar's rally in late 2008 was largely the result of nervous US investors repatriating their investments from emerging economies and US businesses holding cash. Soon, however, particularly as government debt expanded and the bailouts and the stimulus, and the first round of quantitative easing, gold and other commodities rose. Successive rounds of QE, and we are in the midst of the third and the largest at this time, were justified as necessary to keep the economy from tipping over into recession, into depression. While QE is widely credited with preventing the Great Recession from turning into an outright depression, it has so far failed to power a recovery. And by the way, thereby hang many tales, which I'm not going to tell in this paper. The dollar began to strengthen with the end of the first round of quantitative easing, and at the end of 2009, and the onset of the euro crisis. However, it turned downward again with the launch of QE2 in mid-2010, and continued to do so until the end of QE2 and the Fed's announcement that it would no longer continue with that program. The dollar's recovery, despite the ongoing eurozone crisis, remained weaker than after the end of QE1. QE3, nicknamed QE Infinity because of the Fed's announcement that it would continue to purchase banks' bad assets until there was an improvement in employment levels in the United States, was not launched until the fall of 2012. An interesting thing here is that though the dollar did begin to weaken after QE3 was announced, it then strengthened again. The principal reason is that against the background of the eurozone crisis, the US stock market has been rising in defiance of the lack of improvement in economic fundamentals, simply because of the vast amount of liquidity that continues to slosh around world markets and has run out of assets to flow into. This bubble too is likely to burst in time, and when it does, the only question is whether the fall in the dollar's value will be gentle or catastrophic. So now what I want to do is, that's a very quick overview of what's happened since. So you can see the trend is probably still downwards since the crisis. Now, since 1971, what has happened? This is the next chart I want to show to talk about that, those developments. The secular decline of the dollar in the aftermath of the crisis is simply the continuation of the dollar's long-term decline since the gold window was closed in 1971 and currencies began officially floating against each other in 1973. This is clear from this figure. By the way, these are all trade-weighted dollar indexes, so I'm using them as a proxy. You can have a number of different types of measures of the dollar's value. Contrary to the Bretton Woods II view that the closing of the gold window merely liberated the United States from having to exchange the dollar for gold, and benign neglect by US policymakers has since then sufficed to hold up its value, the US dollar's career as the world's money has been anything but smooth. Not only did successive US administrations have to engage in a series of attempts to shore up the dollar's value, it has continuously declined despite these series of efforts. If you basically ignore these two, which I'm going to talk about in a second, you can see a basic long-term decline in the dollar since 1973. Given the bias towards assuming that the US dollar's world role has been unproblematic, or at least inexplicably dominant, because people love paradoxes here, and if you ask questions, they effectively give you answers that make you, that are designed to make you feel extremely stupid, because, you know, they say, oh, well, it only appears like that, the dollar will only fall because you're too naive to understand the real mechanisms behind it, etc., etc. Anyhow, and I have a quotation here from a very highly respected scholar, which I won't go into for in the interest of time, but you all know the kind of discourse I think that I'm talking about. So if it comes up in the Q&A, I'll quote it in detail. But it is also, my own argument is that it is also possible to see this data from a different perspective, in which the dollar's secular decline has only been interrupted, albeit spectacularly, twice. The first time by the recession-inducing Volcker shock, and the second by the stock market bubble of the late 1990s, both proved unsustainable. Worse, the housing bubble that replaced the stock market bubble, that is the period since then, this is what I'm talking about now, rather than leading to a rise in its value, could do little more than moderate its decline. In that sense, the dollar's decline after the late 2008 rally is simply a resumption of this decline that began in 2000 after the bursting of the stock market bubble. As those who pay attention to these things know well, despite the rhetoric of the US empire in the 2000s, and though the Bretton Woods II thesis was advanced in that decade, the decade was punctuated with report after report in the business and financial pages that major reserve currency accumulators, preeminently China, but also others, were looking for ways to diversify their reserve holdings away from the decreasingly valuable dollar. Their actions are reflected in the fact that the dollar's share of foreign currency reserve went from 71% in 1999, the peak of the stock market bubble, to about 61% today, even though reserve accumulation as a whole has leapt up in this decade, thanks to 1997-98 East Asian financial crisis and the imperatives it generated for emerging market economies to self-insure against financial debacles in the future. The dollar's world role, now I'm going back to sort of backtracking a little bit to the story I tell. I'm lifting out parts of the story I tell in geopolitical economy. The dollar's world role was problematic simply because the United States could not provide the world with dollar liquidity through capital exports. Britain had been able to export capital thanks to her colonial surpluses. The US had no formal colonies. Moreover, the sharpening of international competition and working class assertion, which meant employment levels were politically sensitive in ways they had never been during the time of Sterling's dominance, made maintaining high growth rates imperative. In these circumstances, the US could not export capital in any substantial amounts, myths about the significance of Marshall Aid notwithstanding. It was actually quite tiny. It could only provide liquidity by incurring deficits, a method that Robert Triffin had early on warned would be destabilizing and counterproductive. Deficits were necessary for liquidity, but they undermine the dollar's value. These predicted and predictable difficulties led, first of all, to the drain of U.S. gold, and eventually to the closing of the gold window. Thereafter, it has not gone away. It has continued to put constant downward pressure on the value of the dollar. Ironically, ideas of U.S. hegemony have their roots in the international financial intermediation hypothesis, which influential U.S. economists like Charles Kindleberger began to float in the 1960s in order to assure the world that the Triffin dilemma was inapplicable to the United States, because the U.S. was not just another national economy, they said. It was, they said, the world's banker, and the depth and size of its financial markets and private confidence in them would ensure that the dollar would be perfectly able to play its world role. However, the fate of the US dollar since the early 70s does not inspire confidence in the international financial intermediation hypothesis and in ideas about US hegemony. Only a series of financializations attempting to realize the IHIF wager, that is the international financial intermediation hypothesis wager, of the world, of the US being a banker to the world, would briefly and precariously hold up the dollar's value. This can be seen in figure 3, and this, by the way, is a wonderful chart which I have not had time to replicate. Unfortunately, it only goes from 1950 to 2000, but if you were to extend it, I'm sure that the as you will see in a later graph that I'm going to show you, the increase in international capital flows since that time will be even larger than anything shown on this graph. So this is basically, again, I can't spend a lot of time on this, but the major peak that you see here, this is Marshall Aid. This is the recycling of oil surpluses through US banks in the 1970s. This is Japanese financing of American deficits. This here is the East Asian financial crisis. You see a steep drop. There should be another big peak for the stock market bubble under in the 1990s, and then an even bigger one for the mortgage-backed securities thing. As I say, you will see another graph which is much more up to date. But this is more detailed because it shows you capital outflows from particular parts of the world. And most of this, of course, is dollar-denominated, giving U.S. banks, etc., and basically creating the liquidity that the U.S. dollar needed to have. So contrary to ideas about Bretton Woods II and associated assumptions about U.S. hegemony, benign neglect, and so on, the unbacked dollar plunged in currency markets by the spring of 1973, with currencies floating against one another and the Europeans announcing the first step of what would become their long road to the euro, the so-called snake, their first step in currency coordination. Only US intervention in currency markets that summer could save it. How long its effects could have lasted was anybody's guess. Negotiations in the Committee of 20 began revisiting Keynes's ideas for a supranational currency. When the dollar was further struck with the quadrupling of oil prices later that year, however, the US managed to scuttle alternative means of recycling the resulting oil revenues and ensured instead that they would be deposited in US banks, giving rise to this big chunk here. Only the vast increase in dollar liquidity these moves generated could stabilize the dollar. And of course, since then, to an important extent, the oil trade has been an important support for the US dollar's value. This was the first of the dollar-denominated financializations. And by the way, I also consider this very different from what was to come later, but we can discuss that later on. This one involved the lending of oil revenues to developing and communist countries, where they often powered substantial industrialization with practically free capital. It was brought to an end, of course, by the Volcker shock. In the 1980s, moreover, high interest rates and capital inflows from debtor countries could not in themselves hold up the dollar. These factors had to be supplemented by a political arrangement under which the Japanese agreed to finance the US's widening fiscal and payments deficit in exchange for access to US markets, but also sent the dollar soaring so high that by 1985, many considered it widely out of whack with fundamentals, such as rising US budget and payments deficits. Fears that it would crash catastrophically remained, and these fears led to the so-called Plaza Agreement to coordinate a decline in the dollar's value. Again, I'm going to skip a couple of things here. You also know that, of course, this period, basically since 1973, has also been the period in which we have suffered from an increasing incidence of financial crises. So what is widely known as financialization, which has characterized this period, constituted in reality a number of discrete episodes, of which those centered on the dollar were the largest and most fundamental. Another aspect of this point is that financialization does not just have a history, it also has a very distinctive geography. And I think it's important for us to understand that all of them were very dollar-centered, even to some extent euro-centered. Given the centrality of these financializations to keeping markets for the dollar and dollar-denominated assets liquid, it is no coincidence that, as Bordeaux and Eichengreen showed, between the periods of 45 and 71, and 73 to 97, the incidence of financial crisis more than doubled for industrial countries and nearly quintupled for emerging markets. Between the Plaza Accord of 1985 and the reverse Plaza Accord of 1995, which was an agreement between mainly the US and Japan to increase the dollar's value, a number of key developments set the stage for globalization, quote unquote, and empire, quote unquote. Or what amounts to the same thing, the different financializations associated with the stock market and housing bubbles. Nixon had lifted capital controls in 1973 in order to facilitate the recycling of petrodollars. By the late 1980s, having learned from the Third World Debt Crisis that nearly brought them down, major US financial institutions shifted from direct to securitized forms of lending. And in the United States, the chairmanship of the US Federal Reserve passed from Paul Volcker, an opponent of financial deregulation, to Alan Greenspan, an outright supporter, indeed cheerleader. Finally, the US undertook push for financial liberalization elsewhere in other countries in a bid to increase international dollar-denominated financial flows. Though emerging economies were lured into financial liberalization with arguments about how this would enable capital to flow into their economies to boost their economic growth, the sort of short-term capital inflows that the US dollar-denominated international financial system, the US-centered dollar-denominated international financial system now generated could only inflate asset bubbles, not expand production. One result was the East Asian financial crisis. And also the other various financial crises that took place in the 1990s. Only after the 1997-98 East Asian financial crisis did the real intent behind financial liberalization become completely clear, as capital began to flow more or less exclusively into the US economy and dollar-denominated assets. Under globalization, it flowed into the US stock market as Federal Reserve Chairman Alan Greenspan conjured up illusions about the US's new economy. By the way, I should add that this particular part of my book relies a great deal on Doug Henwood's own work on the new economy. So he had illusions about the new economy and the hidden productivity miracle, and it flowed into the swelling market for US mortgage-backed securities as Greenspan and his successor Ben Bernanke told new fairy tales about the trajectory of US house prices and the justification of capital flows into the United States. Though attention has been focused on Chinese purchases of US debt in the 2000s, the liquidity of the dollar actually required much faster financial flows into dollar-denominated assets. As figure 6 shows, this is the one. This is from a paper written, a Bank of International Settlements working paper, on the collapse of the financial flows. That big drop you see, this is 95, this is 07, 08, 09, 10. And I have one more video I will show you in this respect. People have tended to focus on net flows and pointed to China. You know, these Asians, they saved too much, they caused the financial crisis by saving too much. In reality, it was gross flows that gave the dollar its liquidity. The Europeans were buying the mortgage-backed securities and other of these, what we now call the toxic assets, and that's why they are in trouble. The Chinese are not in trouble. It's a very important thing to remember. So anyway, this is what we see here. And you can see that these international financial flows that are very, very important to the dollar's world role collapsed, they have recovered. But in fact, let me show you. This is from a recent paper from McKinsey Global Institute. This is 1980. 2008 collapse. It has recovered, and I'm going to talk a bit about that recovery as well. So I'll conclude in a minute or so. And I won't go through the whole paper, but I will conclude with this one chart here. So despite the rhetoric of the U.S. authorities about the strength of the U.S. economy leading in the years leading up to the crisis, the dollar's downward slide continued throughout the decade, and emerging economies attempted to diversify their reserve holdings away from the dollar. Now, here's an aspect of the story I haven't fully investigated. I think that a very interesting set of books and papers should be written about how the euro constituted the Europeans' attempt at financialization, which has been rudely interrupted by the present crisis, but they got into the game quite late. Thankfully, for their own sakes. But anyway, the dollar's downward slide continued. Those who argue that the dollar's world remains intact point to the absence of alternative reserve assets. Certainly, this has constrained emerging economy central bankers. It's true, and that's why they complain about it. However, it has not prevented the construction of a range of alternative arrangements to displace the dollar, including proposing an expanded role for special drawing rights, barter and swap arrangements for trade financing, regional institutions for reserve pooling, and even a BRICS development bank and a contingent reserve agreement. Moreover, the use of other national currencies as reserve currencies is this chart now. The post-crisis patterns of growth and international capital flows is also less conducive to the sorts of financialization that have occurred until recently. Quite simply, the most financialized economies are the ones that are in gravest economic difficulties. When, after 2008, international financial flows collapsed, the Eurozone accounted for most of that collapse, just as it had accounted for most of the increase over the previous decade. By late 2012, international financial flows did recover to about 40% of their 2007 peak, largely thanks to the massive and ongoing bailout of US financial institutions that passes for QE. However, the key problem here is that there are very few asset classes that this money can be invested in. Currencies and commodities have been the chief arenas for speculation. However, and I'll end on this point, in reality, this money now faces a very, very different type of international financial system, which has objectively become much more national in a certain way, and this is now become a subject of complaint even in the business papers. That is to say, the new forms of regulation that are emerging, and the limits, because at the end of the day, when there is a crisis, it is national governments that have to be involved in bailouts. The fact that they are national governments then means that if you are going to engage in activity which requires a bailout, you have to think about the national jurisdictions within which you are operating. I think I'll end there, and I'm hoping for a really good question and answer.